Chapter 8 Muhammad Ali's struggle for Syria and Palestine. Egypt's defeat. The conflict with the Porte. Muhammad Ali's failure in the Morea acted as a stimulus in his struggle for Syria and Palestine. He could not realize his plans for the creation of a great Arab power without gaining possession of these two countries. Syria and Palestine protected Egypt from attacks from the east and served as a shield against the Turkish menace. The annexation of Syria would strengthen Muhammad Ali's eastern borders and Egypt's independence of the Porte. And Syria itself was a tempting prize. It was one of the richest provinces of the Ottoman Empire. It produced raw silk, wheat, wool, olive oil and valuable fruits, and it could also become a profitable market for Egypt's growing industry. Muhammad Ali was well aware of the Sultan's weakness and knew he could force the Sultan to accept any conditions. With this in view, he began preparing for a struggle against the Porte. In consequence of the unfortunate war of 1828-29, wrote Marx, the Porte had lost her prestige in the eyes of her own subjects. As usual with Oriental empires, when the paramount power is weakened, successful revolts of pashas broke out. As early as October 1831, commenced the conflict between the Sultan and Mehmed Ali, the Pasha of Egypt, who had supported the Porte during the Greek insurrection. See Karl Marx, New York Daily Tribune, November 21, 1853. The war against the Porte began in 1831. There was a two-year delay because of the Franco-Egyptian plans for the conquest of North Africa. Muhammad Ali's relations with his western neighbors were far from friendly, and he had long nurtured the idea of seizing Maghreb. The conditions for such a conquest in 1829-30 seemed to be ripe. Relations with France, Muhammad Ali's most important ally, had been normalized. In 1829, the French offered to finance a campaign against North Africa, to which the Pasha agreed. The Egyptians were to seize Tripoli, Tunisia and Algeria. Muhammad Ali formed a 40,000-strong army under the command of Ibrahim for the campaign against Africa, but demanded that, besides money, France should give him 480 gunships. The French refused and offered instead the assistance of their fleet. This arrangement was highly distasteful to Muhammad Ali, who wished to fight in Maghreb under the flag of Islam. In 1830, France put forward a new plan for a joint campaign. The Egyptians were to seize Tripoli and Tunisia, while France was to take Algeria. But Muhammad Ali rejected this plan, too. In the end, he completely refused to participate in the Algerian campaign, which the French undertook by themselves, while Muhammad Ali devoted himself wholly to the events in Syria. A dispute over 6,000 Egyptian fellaheen, who had fled in 1831 to Palestine to avoid recruitment, served as an excuse for a revolt against the Sultan. The situation by this time had become quite strained. Muhammad Ali was openly refusing to obey the Porte. Having refused to participate in the Russo-Turkish War, he also refused to pay the indemnities agreed on by the Treaty of Adrianople. He felt he had paid tribute in blood in the Morea for many years in advance. Crete, he reasoned, could not compensate for the losses in the Morea, and he insisted on having Syria and Palestine too. In the meanwhile, 6,000 peasants fled from Egypt and found refuge in the domains of the Yaqub Pasha, Abdullah. Muhammad Ali demanded the return of the fugitives. Abdullah refused to give them up, declaring that, being the subjects of one ruler, they could live in any part of the Ottoman Empire they'd liked. Muhammad Ali then began military operations. In a word, he remained loyal to the Sultan. He said he was not declaring war on the Porte, but on the Yaqub Pasha. In effect, the campaign against Abdullah developed into the Turco-Egyptian War. The First Syrian Campaign, 1831-33. The superiority of the Egyptians over the Turks made itself felt from the very outset. The Turkish army was in a state of complete decay. The Turkish fleet was destroyed at Navarino, Marx wrote, The old organization of the army was defeated by Mahmud, and the new one had not yet been created. Marx and Engels, Works, 2nd Rus. Ed., Volume 28, p. 257. The war against Russia weakened the Turkish army still further. The Egyptian army was well armed and disciplined. It had a series of victories to its credit in Arabia, the Sudan, and Greece. Moreover, military expenditure and indemnities had forced the Porte to raise taxes, and this was causing discontent among the masses. Peasant uprisings flared up throughout Turkey. The population of both the Arab and Turkish regions hailed the Egyptians as deliverers from the Sultan's rule. Turkey was unprepared for the war and showed signs of hesitation. For 6 months, the Porte took no action. Only in March 1832, did the Turks really begin to prepare for the campaign, which had already begun. On April 23, 1832, the Sultan declared Muhammad Ali a rebel and relieved him of his duties. This was equal to a declaration of war. The Egyptians made the best of the time factor. In October 1831, Ibrahim Pasha launched a campaign. 2 or 3 weeks later, not having encountered any serious resistance, Egyptian troops occupied Gaza, Jaffa, Haifa, and at the end of November 1831, advanced on Acre, the fortress which had once barred Napoleon's path. After a 6 month siege, from November 26, 1831, to May 27, 1832, Acre fell. By this time, the main forces of the Egyptians were far away in the north. The first big battle against the Turks took place on July 8, 1832, near the city of Horns. In this battle, the Turks, commanded by 9 pashas, were crushed. Over 4,000 were killed or taken prisoner. They lost all their artillery and transports. The Egyptians lost only 100 men. Having triumphed in Horns, Ibrahim occupied Hama and Aleppo and then headed for the Bilan mountain pass, situated between Antakya, Antioch, and Alexandretta. The pass was the key to the heart of the Ottoman Empire, Asia Minor, and here were stationed the main forces of the Turkish army, under the command of Serdar Ekrem Hussein Pasha. On July 29, 1832, Ibrahim attacked and shattered the Turkish forces. Hussein Pasha fled to Adana with the remnants of his army, leaving the whole of Syria to the Egyptians. The Egyptian troops entered Anatolia. They occupied Adana and then proceeded westwards. The Sultan dismissed Hussein Pasha and appointed Muhammad Reshid Pasha commander-in-chief. But this did not affect the course of the military operations. The third and last decisive battle of the war was waged on December 21, 1832, near Konya. The Turks threw their remaining 60,000 men against 30,000 Egyptians. Ibrahim proved a brilliant leader in the ensuing battle. Although outnumbered by 2-1, he surrounded the Turks and utterly defeated them. After the Battle of Konya, the Sultan had no troops left. The way to the empire's capital lay open. The Egyptian advance guard soon entered Bursa. Istanbul was threatened. The confused Sultan turned to the powers for help. France openly supported Egypt and refused to help the Sultan. Russia openly sided with the Turks. England's position was complicated. She was against Muhammad Ali, but feared the Turco-Egyptian conflict might lead to Russian intervention and consequently, to the strengthening of Russia's influence or the division of the Ottoman Empire into two parts. The northern, which would be dependent on Russia, and the southern under Muhammad Ali, which would become a sphere of French influence. England, therefore, did all in her power to iron out the differences and preserve the integrity of the Ottoman Empire, where British influence was prevalent. England, in fact, bided her time and avoided rendering any direct aid to the Sultan. In such circumstances, there was nothing left for the Porte to do but to turn to Russia for help. Muhammad Ali's success worried the Russians. According to the Russian foreign minister, Count Nesselrode, the aim of Russian intervention was to save Constantinople from the possibility of a coup d'etat, which would be a detriment to our interests and lead to the downfall of a weak, yet friendly state. Were they to substitute it for a stronger state under the French, it would be a source of all sorts of difficulties. Russia, therefore, came out in defense of the empire's integrity and the Sultan's sovereignty. On December 21, 1832, the Russian representative at Istanbul made an official offer of Russian military aid. General Muravyov set out with a special mission to the shores of the Bosporus, and from there proceeded to Egypt. He arrived at Alexandria on January 13, 1833, and communicated the demands of Nicholas I to Muhammad Ali. Muhammad Ali agreed to a compromise. He promised Muravyov to check the advance of his troops on Istanbul, stop military operations and recognize the supreme authority of the Sultan. The panic in Istanbul, however, did not die down. Revolts instigated by Ibrahim Pasha's agents flared up in Asia Minor. On February 2, 1833, the Egyptians occupied Kutahya. On February 3, Mahmud II made an official request for Russia's help, and a Russian squadron entered the Bosporus on February 20, 1833. The landing of the 20,000-strong Russian Expeditionary Corps began on March 23, 1833. Its headquarters was situated on the Asian shores of the Bosporus at Unkiarsky Lessee, near the Sultan's summer residence. At the same time, another Russian corps was sent to the Danube to advance on the Turkish capital by land. The Russian intervention seriously alarmed England and France. They hastened to reconcile Muhammad Ali with the Sultan so as to deprive the Russians of an excuse for keeping their troops on the Bosporus. To drive the point home, England and France carried out joint naval demonstrations off the coast of Egypt. On May 4, 1833, at Kutahya, a peace treaty was signed between Turkey and Egypt through the mediation of England and France. Formally, this was not a peace treaty in the legal sense of the word. The Sultan issued a unilateral firman, confirming Muhammad Ali's right to Egypt, Crete, Arabia, and Sudan, and making him the ruler of Palestine, Syria and Cilicia. Muhammad Ali had to withdraw from Anatolia and recognize the Sultan's suzerainty. By the rule of the powers, Egypt remained the vassal of the defeated Porte. The results of the war. The UNKIRSKELESSI Treaty. Russia's intervention had saved Mahmud II. He retained his throne and empire, but he was still in a critical position. Both sides were dissatisfied with the Kutahya Treaty and regarded it as a truce. The Sultan was eager for revenge. Muhammad Ali wanted independence. A new conflict was inevitable, and Russian diplomacy did not fail to take advantage of this. On the eve of the evacuation of the Russian troops, July 8, 1833, Turkey signed the famous 8-year Unkiarsky Lessee Treaty, which provided for the creation of a military alliance between Russia and Turkey. Russia undertook to send her troops to the Sultan's aid, should the need arise. In this connection, Nesselrod remarked, "We now have a legal basis for an armed intervention in Turkey's affairs." Turkey undertook to close the Dardanelles to warships of all nations, whenever Russia demanded it. The Munchengratz Convention, signed on September 18, 1833, between Russia and Austria during a meeting of the emperors in Munchengratz, was a supplement to the Unkiarsky-Lessee Treaty. The convention was soon signed by Prussia. The signatory powers undertook to support the existence of the Ottoman Empire under the present dynasty, and to use all effective means at their disposal. 2. To oppose by common efforts any combination that may cause detriment to the rights of the supreme government in Turkey, either by the establishment of an interim regency or a complete change of dynasty. Finally, the first secret clause stipulated that the provisions of Article 2 should be applied specifically to the Pasha of Egypt, to prevent the direct or indirect spread of his supreme power to the European provinces of the Ottoman Empire. In the end, British and French diplomacy paralyzed the practical results of the Unkiarsky-Lessee Treaty and the Munchengratz Convention. These agreements, nevertheless, did constitute a serious obstacle to the realization of Muhammad Ali's plans and deprived him of the fruits of his victory in the first Syrian campaign. The Turco-Egyptian War resulted in the formation of two states within the framework of the formerly united Ottoman Empire. Muhammad Ali exercised control over Egypt, the Sudan, Syria, Palestine, Arabia, Cilicia and Crete, and only Anatolia, Iraq and a few regions of the Balkan Peninsula remained in the hands of the Sultan. Muhammad Ali's empire was more densely populated, vaster, stronger and richer than that of Mahmud II. The situation was fraught with a new conflict which was not long in making itself felt. Ibrahim's reforms in Syria and Palestine, 1832-40. The political plans of Muhammad Ali and his son Ibrahim, the supreme ruler of Syria, went very far. Both dreamed of creating a large independent Arab state. His real design is to establish an Arabian kingdom including all the countries in which Arabic is the language, George Antonius, The Arab Awakening, L. Hamilton, p. 31, wrote Lord Palmerston about Muhammad Ali in 1833. A French envoy, Baron de Bois-le-Comte, who paid Ibrahim a visit at the time, related that Ibrahim made no secret of his intention to revive Arab national consciousness and restore Arab nationhood, to instill in the Arabs a real sense of patriotism and to associate them in the fullest measure in the government of the future empire. Baron de Bois-le-Comte added that Ibrahim was active in spreading his ideas of national regeneration. In his proclamations he had frequently referred in stirring terms to the glorious periods of Arab history and had infected his troops with his own enthusiasm. He had surrounded himself with a staff who shared his ideas and worked for their dissemination. However, the conditions for the consolidation of the Arab nation had not yet matured. The Arab bourgeoisie of Syria was still very weak. Feudalism had not been liquidated. Ibrahim Pasha, who was a talented politician, made a careful study of the experience of the advanced countries of the time. He saw the tendencies of future development and tried to accelerate their realization. He carried out a series of reforms in Syria, which, like the reforms of Muhammad Ali in Egypt, were aimed at the centralization of the country, the liquidation of feudal arbitrary rule and separatism, and the creation of prerequisites for the development of capitalist relations. First of all, Ibrahim tried to turn Syria into a granary of the future Arab Empire. To check the decline of farming, he ruled that the fellaheen pay a fixed tax. He forbade arbitrary feudal extortions and exempted the newly plowed land from taxation for many years. He settled Bedouins on abandoned land, forcing them to give up their nomadic way of life. Thus new villages were built and close to 15,000 feddan of virgin land were brought under cultivation in the steppe between Damascus and Aleppo. During the first 2 years of Egyptian rule the area under cultivation rose from 2,000 to 7,000 feddan in the fertile Hauran Valley. The Turkish army had always been notorious for its marauding. But Ibrahim sent his troops on a campaign against the Turkish army, thereby putting an end to the continuous devastation of the Syrian crops. The liquidation of the tax anarchy promoted the development of industry and trade. Now the merchants and the artisans had no need to fear for the safety of their property. They had no need to fear the plundering and blackmail of the Turkish pashas. They knew the exact amount of the tax they had to pay and could freely dispose of the remainder of the surplus value which they had collected. With a boldness hitherto unknown, they circulated and turned into capital the rotting treasures hidden from the covetous eyes of the pashas and their ebeys. The custom houses were wrested from the tax farmers and fixed customs duties were introduced. This policy, which was conducive to economic development, led to the growth of Syrian towns and foreign trade. The liberty granted to trade by the Egyptians gave new life to the seaports. Saida, Beirut and Tripoli became free markets where the mountaineers could exchange their silk and olive oil for wheat and European manufactured goods. Output in the Lebanon increased by at least one-third and the consumption of overseas goods doubled, Russian consul Bazili wrote. Roads inside the country and caravan routes through the desert linking Damascus with Baghdad were made safe. Transit trade expanded. British cloth was sent via Syria to Mesopotamia and Iran. Goods from India and Iran passed through Syria to Europe. Ibrahim waged a fierce struggle against the Syrian feudal lords. Naturally, he could not destroy the feudal mode of production and the feudal class domination that went with it. But he strove to end feudal separatism, restrict the political rights of individual feudal rulers, and replace the indocile seniors with men who would obey him absolutely. In the Lebanon, for instance, he depended on Emir Bashir II, who continued the war against other Lebanese feudal lords in the name of Ibrahim Pasha. In Nablus, Ibrahim depended on the Abd al-Hadi sheikhs in his struggle against the other sheikhs. Ibrahim consolidated the central authority and reorganized the administration of the country along Egyptian lines. Syria, Palestine and Cilicia were divided into six provinces or mudirias headed by mudirs. Deputies of the central power, mudazilims, were appointed in each town. The sheikhs of the neighboring villages were subordinate to the mudazilims. Each mudazilim headed a consultative organ, Majlis, or Shura, which was formed from among the local landowners, merchants and clergy. The Majlises were given the functions of civil courts. The highest judicial authority was in the hands of Ibrahim, who personally passed sentence on criminal and political cases after their preliminary consideration by the courts. Educational reforms were also introduced during Egyptian rule. The first Lebanese printing house was founded in 1834 in Beirut. In the same year, Ibrahim initiated a wide program of primary and secondary education. He established primary schools all over Syria and founded secondary colleges in Damascus, Aleppo and Antioch. The pupils were boarded at government expense. They wore uniforms and were given a strict military education, as was the custom in Egyptian schools. The teaching was conducted in Arabic. The American traveler, George Antonius, related that the school director, the famous Klot Bey, received instructions to inculcate a true sense of Arab national sentiment. George Antonius, op. cit. p. 40. Like Muhammad Ali, Ibrahim was known for his religious tolerance, which was an unusual trait among the Turkish pashas. Ibrahim freed the Arab Christians, in whose hands were concentrated the crafts and urban trade, from many humiliating restrictions forced on them by the Turks.